Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to What's Happening, Dracut. Today is Wednesday, April 26th, 2023, and we are on our 47th episode. Can you imagine that? Well, thanks for joining us tonight. We are at our overly ostentatious studios here located at Dracut Access Television on Mill Street in Dracut, and we have a packed show for you tonight.
49.
Oh, is it 49? My mistake. 49th. Today is 49. Wow. We're one away from 50, Phil.
We'll have to have a celebration of some sort.
We're
going
to have to do something. 50 coming up.
And,
you know, I should have checked with them before I finished my notes here today. But we are going to give you information that you probably will get nowhere else right here tonight. So I'm John Zimini. I'm the lead host for tonight's show, and we hope to keep this conversation lively and moving along. Tonight, we have in the house the Teflon Don of Dracut Access Television and Dracut Politics, an all-around good guy, Gordy Scott. He's in the house. Hi, Gordy.
Hey, how's everyone tonight?
I'm great. How about you?
Good.
Are you upbeat and ready to roll?
I'm ready to roll.
Yeah, how's everything at home? Family good? Life?
Yeah, we got
a
lot.
Is your wife on tonight?
She's watching. Yeah, she's definitely watching.
Does she press a little button? is there something under your seat to give you a shock?
Shock, yeah.
If you say something out of the way?
Yeah, exactly.
Because, you know, our wives are always our biggest critiques.
Yes.
Right? Biggest critics, right?
Yeah.
And in the house with us is number one world's best overall greatest architect in the universe, in my opinion.
Wow.
Phil Tebow.
Good evening.
How are you, Phil?
Very well. How are you?
Good, good. What's going on?
A lot of stuff going on. You can rest assured that Lorraine is not watching this. She'll be watching the Bruins game.
The Bruins, that's right.
Game 5. And
are we on live, by the way?
Yes, we are.
We're going to make sure we get comments.
There's plenty to talk about. Yeah. As a matter of fact, fireworks will be talked
about. Oh, yeah. There's going to be a few fireworks.
And we won't use small ordinances.
No, I know. Yeah, and you know, Phil, we got so much to talk about. You got zoning issues. We got the Economic Development Committee, and you know, they made an appointment the other night. You saw that, right?
I noticed that. I'm not surprised that I didn't get
you
an
didn't
interview.
Get that one either, right?
No, I didn't even get an interview.
Yeah, of course not. I don't think they interviewed anybody. In fact, you know.
Well, doesn't that go against their procedures?
Of course.
But we'll talk about that.
Yeah,
later.
We will. But in the house with us tonight is the one and only Rob Shepard, who ran for school committee and has gone in feet first in all the committees in town. Rob Shepard, how are you?
Hi, good. Thanks for having me.
You're on the Conservation Commission.
Yes, Open Space.
And you're on Open Space also?
Yes, sir. And Community Preservation Committee as well.
By appointment from the Conservation? Or?
No, Open Space through the Selectman appointee.
Through the Selectman, oh, that's cool. So that's good. You're on a couple committees, so we can talk about you can weigh in on a number of different issues tonight. We're happy to have you on the show tonight. Before we get to that, we want you to know that you can join in the fun on Facebook. We are in Facebook Live. You can also watch us live streaming on
DracutTV.org.
Yeah, they say now I can't make a mistake. So I took him off guard, obviously.
You did.
With the young stud.
I was waiting for you to say it, and I was going to jump
in. Of course you were, but you see how I handed that off? I gave you the chance to have a Joe Biden moment, but we won't even go there. But you can watch us on Facebook. As I said, we're live streaming on Dracut Access Television, and you can also catch us on, I think, are we still uploading on YouTube?
Yep.
And Gordy
Fitzgerald. Episodes on YouTube, yep.
Yeah, so 49 episodes, wow.
Yep. And you can stream it right from your TV. You go to YouTube and just type in What's Happening, Dracut, and we'll pop up.
Who would have thought we would have
47.
Done that? Yeah. So, we could also try to get on that new program that Tucker Carlson is going on to.
Oh.
What is it? It's an app, right? So we'll have to talk about that later. But you can also join us by calling in at 978-957-4243 and join in the conversation if you'd like. But before we get into any of the discussion tonight and all the issues that occurred at last night's Board of Selectmen meeting and others, we're going to have our weather report from our resident weatherman, Sean Kelly of Mill City Weather. Take it away, Sean.
Hi, guys. Thanks for having me on once again. Here's the forecast for tonight. Temps are going to drop into the low 40s tonight with a passing shower. Winds won't be that bad at 5 to 10 miles an hour. And then as we head into the day on Thursday, there is a slight chance for a shower, about a 20% chance for a shower in the morning hours. Very nice day overall, though. Sun and clouds, especially as we head into the second part of the day on Thursday. Winds are going to be coming out of the north at 5 to 10 miles an hour. Then as we head into Thursday night, temps are going to drop back into the upper 30s and near 40 degrees with partly cloudy conditions. Winds won't be that bad coming out of the west at 5 to 10 miles an hour. And then as we head into Friday, probably your pick of the week, sun and clouds, winds won't be that bad at 5 to 10 miles an hour. And then as we head into Friday night, temps are going to drop back into the low 40s with mainly clear conditions. And here's a look at your exclusive 8-day forecast. So a shower chance as we head into Thursday morning. Friday is going to be a pick of the week, sun and clouds. Then as we head into next week, so looking unsettled once again. And that is the forecast for now, everyone. Back to you guys in the studio.
Hey, thank you once again, Sean, for a great, you know, weather forecast.
Friday is looking good. I'm going down to Falmouth, Mass for a project. Good. So
you'll have to stop in and have some fresh fish.
I'm going to roll down the windows, and I'll be enjoying myself with that.
At night, it looks a little cold, 40 degrees. Holy cow.
Oh, perfect. Windows open.
But that's okay for tuppy time. Yeah, 40 degrees time, at night is good if you get a little bit. I'd like it really in the 30s for that. But the tub is always good any night of the week. I can get in that tubby and have my little captain.
Your libation.
My little libation while I'm sitting there and, you know, thinking about all the things that we need to do here in Dracut. But we had some good news last night given to Pat Waller and his family.
Yes.
Right. Pat Waller was honored. He's going to be 100 years old.
That's magic.
And he is a local farmer, been around for many, 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 many years. Obviously, 100 years is a long time. But he's also he's a World War II veteran. Yep. And, you know, it's good
to see. The Varnum Award.
The Varnum Award. Yeah. He got the Varnum Award.
Well deserved to honor the man, yeah.
Yeah. Who were some of the other candidates for that
award? To be honest, I don't know. I had been talking with Rebecca Duda, who's also on the committee, about possibly expanding it just from the one, but maybe expanding it beyond that because sometimes I think people get the impression it's almost a competition. It's really not. And Rebecca would tell you that it's not a competition. But maybe by expanding it that they have awards a year. Because you could keep giving these awards to a lot of people, and there's still a lot of people who deserve them that will never get them.
Yeah. So we
congratulations to Frederick Pat Waller.
Yep.
A great honor that he deserves.
Great honor. Very well deserved. And they had a reception for him, and they also had in, which is, I think it's the first time I can recall it happening. They had the runners-up come in, so to speak. Anybody that was nominated.
Was Moose Morawski on that list?
No, he was not. He withdrew. He had his whoever was going to give it to him. By the way, hi, Moose. I know you're out there watching, along with Carol.
Was Frank on the
Donnie.
List?
Frank? Who, McMahon?
Yeah.
One of our number one fans. He's out there watching, I'm sure, right now.
Moose and Frank, yep we're on the list.
They're out there doing their thing, and they're very active for guys their age, you know?
Yeah.
They're out there.
God bless them.
Yeah, God bless them is right, because I'm feeling it every day. I watched my granddaughter yesterday for 3 or 4 hours while my daughter and my son-in-law had to take the younger one to the doctor's for a doctor's appointment. And at the end of 4 hours, I was exhausted. I had to go home and take a nap. It's showing anyways. So is there anybody else we need to say congratulations to or happy birthdays or anything of that nature? I haven't heard anything else, you know?
No, not that I know of.
Okay, so let's just dive into some of this. I had some communication with via text to Louise Tremblay about the community gardens because I've been getting questions about that, when it's going to open and what have you, and she reported back to me that it was rototilled last week and that she's in the process of notifying everybody that they can get up there and start gardening, but she wanted to make sure that the people who were there last year are returning, and she's doing that now. And that if anybody wants to jump into that and get into the fun up there, they can call Louise at 978-866-2882 And or you can get a, you know, call Town Hall in the manager's office, and Samantha of the manager's office will take the information and get it to Louise. It'll put you on a list, and you could get a nice little plot to grow your veggies for the summer. The bottom line here is, it is, vegetables are getting very expensive, so it might be a good idea to do that, you know? So let's dive in. Phil, what is coming up in June? We've got a couple of things, right? You got a town meeting coming up?
So town meeting itself is coming up. There are some 44 articles that will be on the town warrant. To be honest, I just downloaded it today. It was put up on the town website. So there's a lot to go through. Articles, a brief overview. Articles 1 through 18 are financial in nature, for expenditures of monies through for the budget, through enterprise funds, and other related items. Article 19 is for the vocational school to set up a reserve fund. I didn't really get into that.
They want to set up a stabilization. Are you familiar with that at all?
It's like a stabilization.
Stabilization fund, because they are not allowed to by law unless the town sets it up.
Yep.
And they have to have approval at the town meeting.
And then it has to be three schools. It has to be a majority of the schools approve it in each town as well.
Oh, yes. That was at the last meeting as well, right?
Right. Okay. It was. They were talking about it. And I don't know whether Victor mentioned or not how many of the member towns have approved it.
That I don't know. I just started taking a look through these articles.
Okay.
Article 20 is a home rule petition to move our fall town meeting. Typically, it's on the first Monday of the month, and that sometimes falls just before election day.
Right.
And so they want to move it back. They want to move it essentially forward a week, so it'll be the second Monday.
So the typical state and federal elections are held on that first Tuesday.
On the first Tuesday.
So that, I think Janie Boissonneau, by the way, who's doing a great job as the town clerk, she stated last night at the Board of Selectmen meeting that exactly what you said, that they need to move that so that we can
They need the ballot machines at the town meeting.
Right, exactly.
It's hard. Already been programmed.
Yeah. Plus, it gives some of the staff a break from being at the polls all day, and then being at town meeting late, and then having to be at the polls earlier the next day.
Yeah.
So it certainly makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Article 21 is another home rule petition to allow Dracut to make their legal notices through the town website only.
Ooh.
So essentially remove it from notification from a publication in general circulation.
What do you think about that?
I'm not sure. To be honest, both are kind of hiding it in plain sight.
Mm.
If you don't have internet access and can't get the website, well, you won't see it. And if you don't have a subscription to the newspaper, you're not going to see it. Or if you try to find a store that actually carries a newspaper,
yeah,
that's difficult. About a month ago, I have a nephew who lives in Texas, and he collects McDonald's paraphernalia, and the Boston Globe actually did an article on him because he had come up in the area, and so of course. My sister-in-law says, "Hey, Phil, could you get me a couple of copies of the Boston Globe for this article?"
Mm-hmm.
I went through over a dozen stores and I couldn't find any.
You mean because they sold out?
No, because they weren't carrying the paper anymore.
Everything's digital, yeah.
So I can certainly understand the town wanting to go that route. It doesn't necessarily restrict it to only the town website, but other electronic media.
Well, what about the town bulletin board?
So the bulletin board at DATV could be done.
Yep.
Done that. I'm not sure about the electronic signs that are on the street, because that stuff will start churning through so much that it'll be difficult for anybody driving by to actually get, get a
but
message.
I'm also thinking about the physical board that they used to put up the notices on. Are they still maintaining that? Does anybody know that?
They are. They are.
Okay. I don't know, yeah.
Yeah.
But even that for legal notices can get somewhat onerous when you're looking at all the different boards that would have to do a public notice.
I'm not sure.
ZBA, Planning Board, Conservation. You probably even Community Preservation would have to do some sort of notices occasionally.
So while we're on that particular article, and it's an interesting one, if they're going to, did you say they want to restrict it to just the town website?
No, I don't believe so.
Or just be the very least.
But so one. Essentially remove it from the newspaper of local circulation.
Oh.
So they wouldn't be required to advertise in the local papers anymore.
I'm a little nervous about that. They should still have to do that in other media because, not everybody can manage that website. I've gone on today. The new website is very nice. It looks good, but I don't know yet if it's easy to manage.
It's certainly still unfamiliar because I was having difficulty kind of going through it. And I think as you use it, it starts becoming somewhat intuitive.
Yeah. The search engine's really good. It's a little bit better than the last one. I recently used it.
But I heard from a very reliable source, and we're going to dig into this further, they claim that it's ADA
accessible.
Oh. But it's something to do with the pixels. If you have a small monitor, you can't get everything.
Oh, interesting.
So it can't be fully ADA.
There's probably some kinks here and there that they got to iron out.
No doubt there's some applications that somebody who needs that sort of accessibility would have on a program, and much like reading it, essentially text to voice.
Well, I do know somebody that is looking into it, and a couple people have mentioned it to me.
And,
that they have
and look what happens if they do publish only to the website. I don't know if you guys heard, but Lowell, the city of Lowell, their website got hacked.
Last night, Ann Vandal actually mentioned that during the selectman meeting.
Certainly one benefit, if you want to say it's a benefit to an applicant, is that they would no longer have the charge to advertise. And that advertisement fee can be upwards to $750 to advertise in the Lowell Sun.
Right, but now going, the Lowell Sun is been indicating for a number of months now that they're probably going to stop printing the newspaper and just go digital.
Yep.
Did you hear that?
Yeah.
No, because I just signed up for the Sunday paper.
Well, I'm sure they may print a couple times a week, but they're certainly not going to print as much as they do now. And speaking to a couple of people over there, and they're saying, yeah, it looks like we're heading faster to digital than we are anything else. And of course, as you all know, we are now have a real strong association with InsideLowell.
InsideLowell, that's
and
correct.
That's a digital component of media, and they will stream our, they will take our tape from our show and put it on their site. And Phil, you're also writing for that.
That's correct.
What's your latest article?
I just wrote an article. I had titled it "One More Question." It's on InsideLowell as, is this an investment or a lifestyle?
Right.
And it gets into when you're starting a project, a lot of people have, they want to do this or that. And at some point, I typically interrupt a client and say, okay, this addition, are you doing this for a lifestyle or are you doing it for an investment? And they usually ask, what do you mean? And I said, if somebody comes to you tomorrow and you say, I'll pay you five times what your house is worth, do you move out?
Yeah.
My response typically would be, when do you want me to leave?
Yeah, exactly.
So my house is an investment.
Right.
If you asked that same question to my father, he would have said, absolutely not. So his home was a lifestyle.
Right.
I said, and so the article just goes into saying, if you're choosing one or the other, you should design the house accordingly. So if it's a lifestyle, then get what you want in it. And if you're doing it as an investment, just put what you have to.
Is the house going to have roots?
That particular article you wrote was more into your architectural side.
That's correct.
Than it is
so
political.
Yes. So my writings with Inside Lowell, I think from forward from now will be predominantly on a professional level.
Okay, yeah.
Well, my working profession, not that yeah. they won't be a professional article.
Okay, I hear you. So getting back to this particular article, if we can do it in multi-digital media places, then I'm happy with that. But I don't want it to be just restricted to one place.
And again, I don't think it's restricting it to one location. I believe it was just kind of removing it from essentially the written print.
And I think where the town can do some service to themselves is think of themselves more, I shouldn't say this, but more like a business. So they should get a Facebook page, they should get a Twitter.
They have a Facebook page.
But I think they need to post things like this on there because people are more likely to read the social media, the Facebook page or the Twitter page than go on the website and look for something like that.
I don't know, could you make a legal notice in 144 characters or less?
Yeah.
You know,
but you could say we've released our latest legal article.
You could notice
here's the link to
here's
connect.
The link, right.
Yeah. Now, what about in terms of that particular legal notices thing? I mean, I may be going off on a tangent a little bit here, but if you go to the agendas, right, and it lists what's on the agenda, you have experience with it, Rob, at the Conservation Commission. When they list the agenda, they don't list the supporting documents that go along with it somewhere electronically. Do you think that would be a good idea so that people can see what it is?
I would absolutely love to have even the packets of what is being given to the board members that are being brought up there. So a lot of times you just get the agenda. Sometimes, you know, we attended an open meeting seminar that talked about having that line be very specific of what you're going to do in the meeting. So that way when people attend, they know what's going to happen. Well, if you're a little bit vague on there, people aren't really sure. So, you know, if you have the packet, I'll know what's being presented as well. You know, so you wouldn't be as vague, or you could be as vague. But as long as I had that packet and I knew, hey, here's a letter of what is in this according to this line item that says, I don't know, Beaverbrook Farm.
Yeah. Right? So Gordy, you the expert on IT stuff, as far as I'm concerned. And when they, is it a big deal to list or to put in the supporting documents, say they have, I don't know, a donation from Santa Claus that they're going to put a new street in? And
yep, right.
There's a letter of
they have that somewhere. They have that information.
They have it, but they don't.
It's as easy as scanning it. They have the scanners at the office. They can just put the papers in, have a administrative assistant scan that, and then upload it to the website or whatever.
But it's
very simple to do. And again, this goes back to the social media page. Again, I don't think people are going to go, hey, I'm going to go log into the town website today and look what's on there.
Yeah.
I think it's better off like, reminder, there's a town meeting tonight, or reminder, there's a Conservation Commission meeting. Here's the agenda and supporting documents. And post it out there.
I don't know about you, Phil, but I was looking for the town warrants today, and I couldn't
find them.
But there's another thing they could post on social media. Town warrants just released.
Yeah.
I think they need a social media person that does that. All these, when these documents are created and posted, it's very simple, right? We all do it. We all go into Facebook and put a post on there. It doesn't take a lot of time. Just say, here's the link. You know, just release town warrant articles, put a link to it.
Maybe a mobile app?
Yeah.
Yeah. When I was on the Board of Selectmen, we got our packets usually like 48 hours before the meeting so that we could read it. Is that true with all the committees that you're on, Rob?
That you get, what, only a few minutes before? Or sometimes you'll get them in advance. The Conservation Commission is really good about that. We had discussed and said, hey, you know, we're looking to make sure that we have enough information on these developments that are coming in or these notice of intents. And yeah, we get these earlier on, so we're able to review them. I'm not a big fan of getting something a few minutes before my meeting that I have to vote on. That's something I'm personally not a fan of.
Yeah, well, when I used to get that on the Board of Selectmen, I used to say, well, we just got these documents today, so I'm not prepared to make any decisions on it until I can, you know, read it and
digest it,
and then I'll formulate some questions if I have any.
You know who did that? Dr. Duda.
Yeah.
Dr. Duda did that. That was one of the first couple meetings I went to. And
she did that?
She did that.
Yeah. And Phil, do you find that on your committees, the committee you're on?
So
are you still on any committees? Have they eviscerated you from those yet?
No, permanent building committee, I'm still there. And a lot of that So there's not a lot of supporting documents that, that necessarily come up with that because it's a continuing project. And so there are some, sometimes a few documents that are added to it and that we can get access to. But for my time on the planning board, I stress to everybody on the committee that, hey, you need to pick up these packets on Friday so you can look at them over the weekend. We have a meeting on Wednesday, so it gives you sufficient time. And sure enough, you know, some members would walk in, they'd open up the folder, and it's the first time they're seeing any of it.
So and, when yeah. we have this article on the floor of the town, what article number is that? Article 16, I think is it?
For the bylaw, yeah. for the notice?
Yeah.
21? Article 21.
21. Now, can that be amended?
Any article or town meeting can
so
be amended.
So could it be amended to include, you know,
social media
and digital?
Well, again, I think it's just removing the requirement of the local paper of circulation. Okay. It's not restricting it to any one particular area. They're just trying to remove it from essentially a media that may be seen as antiquated.
Okay, so did we beat that horse to death?
Yes.
Yeah, possibly.
Let's go on
possibly.
To the next one.
So,
the next
articles 23 through 39
yeah.
are zoning bylaw reforms.
Wow.
So this. I won't get into it too much, and Rob has been looking at them too. I know that because he's been asking me questions about
it. Yes, sir.
But there's a lot there. I think the work that the Zoning Bylaw Review Committee has done has been very good, very methodical, and they've thought about all of these articles and the changes that are associated with. So it may look like there are some major changes. There's some redefined areas. So. Just as an example, currently our zoning bylaw has an R1, R2, and R3 zone. Yeah. R1 being 1 acre, R2 being 2 acre zoning,
yeah.
R3 being 1 acre zoning but multifamily.
Okay.
So they're condensing that into R1, remaining as 1 acre zoning, single family, and R2 being 22,000 square foot lots for multifamily. So okay. It may sound like a big change, but most of the town in the R3 zone fits that category.
Okay.
So they're essentially taking all of the R3 zone, calling it R2.
So they're just condensing the,
that's correct.
Descriptions of it.
Right. And so they've reduced the size of the lot to make a good portion of them conforming lots. I won't say that every single lot will become conforming because my house is on a 10,000 square foot lot. So they're not going to reduce it down to a 7,000 square foot lot because that just causes a whole host of other issues.
Right. Now, Rob, you had an issue that they were talking about tonight, right?
Yeah. So I promised you I'd come here tonight in
yes.
place of Richard, which thank you, Richard, for allowing me to come on.
Oh, by the way, we didn't even say why Richard's not here tonight. But Richard has a prior commitment tonight, and that's take care of that schoolwork, Richard.
Yes.
Right? And that's what he's
yeah,
doing.
Absolutely.
So he's
good
catching
for him.
Up.
Good yeah. for him, you know. Yeah. So they're changing. I'm in the Meadow Creek development.
Yeah.
So they're changing the zoning map in that location. Right now we are R2. That is the 80,000 square feet. So I looked at things and I said, oh, well, you know, I remember there being a special permit for my development. And I remember they're saying that the golf course will never be actually developed on because it's to change to open space should the golf course in a terrible situation defunct.
Yeah.
But I want to make sure I have that literature. And I understand that because then as someone that lives up there and as someone that spent a lot of money for his home and just as well, there's a lot of Dracut alumni that live up there as well.
Yeah.
And so we all live up there and we'd like to know, are we safe?
Yeah. Yeah
so
yeah.
I'm doing a little research on that and I'm trying to find out.
So you mean to say that when they say that something is in perpetuity, it not necessarily is in perpetuity, right? Right? Because it can be changed.
So my understanding of the golf course and the surrounding community is that the residential subdivision was done as an open space subdivision, which allowed the lots to be reduced to 20,000 square foot lots. Most of them are bigger than that, I know that.
Yeah, we're like roughly just shy of 3/4 of an acre on some of them, but some of them they dropped down to almost a half an acre.
So any space left that is left open, essentially is left over, is essentially dedicated to open space.
Right.
The open space in this particular, for this particular project, ends up being the golf course.
Right.
So there's actually a conservation restriction on the golf course.
Oh, okay. So they can never build on it.
So they can never build on it.
So no matter
if,
what.
If it goes, to be honest, if it went the way of essentially going bankruptcy, and it won't go this way now, I would rather see the town operate it as a municipal golf course, because there aren't enough golf courses in the area.
Right, there's not.
You know, no, Green Meadow over in Hudson is just announced at the beginning of the year that they're essentially closing their two courses.
Oh, wow.
And really? It's going to be, it's a warehouse, not Amazon, but another company.
Oh, interesting, very interesting. So what's the next article you got there?
Gee, I have 40 and 41, and I'm leaving them blank, so we'll skip over those.
Okay,
for now.
We're going to go over.
We have a good month, and so we'll be dedicating the show more to that. Article 43 is an expenditure for a school feasibility study, and that would be for the Campbell School, and they're looking for $1 million for that.
Wow. $1 million for feasibility.
I don't think that it'll reach that. I think Tingsboro did one fairly recently, and there's another community, and they were in the $800,000 range.
Hmm. Did they change the time, the start time of the town meeting? I thought there was some discussion
on that.
That
I don't know. I didn't see that.
Did you see that? I thought we're going to have to research that a little bit more, because I think there was a move to try to change the time.
Earlier?
But I think it got pushed back because many people aren't aware of it, and who's going to be able to get to a town meeting at 6 o'clock? So you may end up waiting till 7 o'clock anyways to get a quorum.
Well, you've heard me talk about Phil's rule of time rule for town meeting. No matter what, it takes 2 hours.
Right.
So we have 44 articles.
Good luck with that.
The big one you didn't mention is John is contributing to.
What's that?
The Uber funds, Uber and Lyft funds, the stabilization fund for that. So they get a fee from the state, but they have to create a fund to put that money into before they can use it.
It's something with the licensing of Uber.
So they can thank you for your.
I don't do a hell of a lot of Ubering in Dracut, trust me, but I do Uber in Boston, as a side gig to keep me busy. But what else there, Phil?
So the last article, Article 44, deals with some street acceptances, and I think there's about a half dozen of them. One of our friends will be happy that Winter Hill Drive will be included in the street acceptances.
They should go there. They go to the meeting.
They should go to the meeting and
to get it approved.
Make sure it gets approved.
Were any of the street acceptances called Zimini Way? Or?
Oh, yeah. Did hell freeze over yet? That'll happen when hell freezes.
We
somewhere.
Don't have enough streets that start with the letter Z.
Z, so yeah. Maybe,
I think most of the streets that we would be talking about are probably called One Way.
Yeah, exactly.
Good
any,
one,
any
Phil.
Street that the politicians
right,
you
that's
know,
a
want
one way.
Name is going to be one, called One Way.
So I guess mine is Do Not Enter.
Yeah. So talk about some of the, for Rob's benefit and for the viewer's benefit, let's talk about some of the CPC issues that are coming.
Yeah, you would certainly have more knowledge of that than I.
Sure. Let's see. I'll try to pull it up. We've got Article 12. Yap Farm. That's on there for $20,000. So that's to finish off the paving. There was a time lapse, and then there was an issue where expenses kind of exceeded a bit. But then things were brought to the CPC and said, hey, we needed a little bit more additional funds, and that's where the $20,000 comes
from. So that's
from
Beaverbrook Farm?
Yap Farm.
Yeah. The Yap Farm. Yeah. Oh, that's the one off of, what's the name?
Richardson.
Of the,
that's off of Richardson.
Richardson Road, yeah.
It's nice up there. Yeah, that is the newest trail that we currently have from that the open space cleared.
And the open space cleared it out.
And last year they built a small parking lot
Yes.
Off of Richardson that somebody could pull
no,
into.
No, I think that's Old Meadow, isn't it?
So that is Old Meadow? Oh, goodness. It's right at the intersection of, I believe it's Methuen Jones. Street, Jones. It's the three-way. You take the left.
Yes. Isn't that Old Meadow?
I don't know.
Street that
I should know the
it
name.
Runs,
Surrey
Lane. Know the it runs into.
Does it run into it? It's not Richardson.
No, so it would be Marshall.
Marshall. Marshall.
It crosses. Right. Marshall crosses Richardson.
Right.
Further down towards Methuen.
So, yeah, I see that little parking lot there. And it says you go down the hill where the log cabin is and all that stuff. And it's right there. So, yeah.
Yeah.
That's interesting. So there's a paving issue there?
Wasn't really, not a big issue. It was that the funds and what needed to be completed, it kind of exceeded a bit at the time through the project. Mm-hmm. Typical projects, you know, the problem with, I shouldn't say a problem, but CPC, when we dedicate funds to it, if we start to exceed it or go a little bit further, the town can't go further than what we've placed in our articles. So there's times where we need to do a contingency factor percentage that comes in, increases it a bit, so that way the town can still complete a project for us and you don't have a situation like this.
Right. So that's one of the CPC articles, right?
Yeah, that's from, I believe, that's a fiscal year 23. But if you go to Article 13, fiscal year 24, we've got a ton. We've actually have a total community preservation of $1.4 million.
Wow.
It's a lot. There's a lot of projects. And I believe it was my first meeting. It was a stack about this big of all the projects coming through. Yeah. And there's applications within there. And the nice thing was Mr. Cody said, all right, here it is. You know, we got it that day, but then we all took it home to read it. So we had a month to read through all our packets, which was nice. So we've got, let's see, field debt payments. So that's one thing I'm going to be asking at this next meeting because this really hadn't been talked about much. So I'm excited to hear about it. But the NFC National Fitness Equipment. So you heard Richard had come on here and talked about that was the location of the fitness court and where it was going to be.
Right.
Previously, it was next to the Veterans Memorial. Now it's a little further away, kind of in the outfield of the second baseball.
How big is that court?
It's about a 30 by 30 court.
Okay.
And it's currently going to have a American flag patriotic design on it too.
Okay.
So one person actually at CPC, when we were debating should we put it on there, they said, well, you know, at the other side of the park, you really don't have something that kind of reminds you, hey, this is Veterans Park. This is what this park stands for. So this kind of is a way to do that. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious to see what the town will think when they vote.
So what will that include? That has outdoor equipment for fitness.
Oh, yeah. There's pull-up bars. There's places to do crunches. I definitely need to do those myself. But, yeah, it's supposed to kind of be a area where, I don't know, if a group wanted to meet up. Say you had the high school football team, right? A couple of the guys that are trying to do summer sessions, head on over there.
So somebody had asked me what kind of mechanical equipment would be in there. Like when you go to a gym or for fitness, right, and you start walking the treadmills, there's not treadmills going to be there.
No. It looks like there's almost like obstacle blocks that you can jump over or that'll help you different inclines.
So it's a body weight training. So you're using your own body weight as your resistance.
It's all stabilized things and or standalone issues, like, you know, like you said, like a pull-up bar.
In Chelmsford, I guess, had recently used CPC funds for there. So if you want to check one out, I believe there's one in Chelmsford.
Yeah. People just ask, isn't the equipment going to rust, right?
It's going to be in the weather, right?
Right. So
apparently that was a big push where there's a warranty on a lot of it as well.
It needs to be maintained. It needs to be painted.
It's all powder coated and stuff like that. Yeah. It's exterior fitness equipment.
Yeah.
So that's going into Veterans Park.
Yes, okay. Sir. And then a big one, the Beaverbrook. So line three, Beaverbrook Farm Design. So that one, there were a bunch of projects happening at Beaverbrook. And we transferred the funds. We took them all and said, all right, these were completed projects throughout. So now let's bring them all together. And this is a study that's going to happen for a handicap accessible trail. Or I should say an ADA.
So they're going to design the trail?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
That's actually something that I'm somewhat familiar with like rail trails.
Right.
I had done the Bruce Freeman Rail Trail. There's a bridge going over Route 2, and that's one of the bridges that that was probably my second bridge that I got designed.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's nice to drive by it, and I'm like, oh, there it is. All right. That geometry, man, I'll never forget that. Like, so everyone has a project that they'll never forget.
Yeah.
That one has about a 30-degree skew, and then at the same time, it's got a horizontal curve to it,
yeah.
And then, oh, we're going to turn a vertical curve in. So it has three different complex geometry.
Wow.
Yeah, it was nice.
Don't go to me for any geometry stuff. Forget it, you know. But that's cool stuff, but okay.
Yeah, yeah. So
how much is that going to be?
That one is $150,000. I believe the study was roughly within the $50,000 range. Now, what happens here is, again, you're looking at dollars being allocated towards projects. And you want to make sure you have enough, but at the same time, I haven't had a big chance to read these yet, and I will be, but I'm assuming that we would also probably locate this towards construction as well.
Yeah. So you two, particularly Phil and you, have a better idea. When somebody says, we're going to design or we're going to install a handicap trail, what does that envision as somebody that doesn't understand that kind of stuff? Like, a handicapped person isn't going to go on a rock ledge or something, a rock-filled walkway. What will be the design entail? Safety issues or whatever?
So there's definitely resting spots. So every so often, the ADA requirement requires a certain rest area, too. They're limited to the gradation for how steep things are.
Yeah.
Another thing would...
is the cross slope, too.
Yes.
So you're not kind of... Tipping over.
It's wheelchair accessible, in other words.
That's, yeah. Yeah.
It would be wheelchair accessible, yeah.
That's my understanding of it, and I'm excited to see the design come through.
Oh, that's great stuff.
That's for the Beaverbrook Farm Ad Hoc Committee.
Okay. And what else do you have on that?
So, let's see. They also have a design study for a tennis and pickleball courts, and that's through Stephen Stone.
Before we get to that,
sure.
Can we go back to the Beaverbrook Farm? Was there some money expended or proposed for the removal of the workshop?
So you're jumping.
Yeah,
Article
okay,
14.
So, okay. All right, so I was just trying to keep a...
No, I'll jump. I'll jump and
go
stay
ahead.
With you. I love hopping.
Okay.
Article 14. So that's the Beaverbrook Farm workshop building. Mm-hmm. That was on, I believe, the November article of last year, or mm-hmm. was it the June of last year? And... That was deferred at that time. So right. That's back on the table. The town manager had deferred it after what had happened with the seed shed. We were kind of going late, and she deferred it.
Right.
It's like, okay. Now it's back on. And when that came back up again at CPC, you know, we're all discussing, we're like, you know, is this the proper funds to be used for demolition? We all waffled. There was a lot of going back and forth because you've bought this property and you want to see it completed, you want to see it done. Well, that design study currently has the parking lot located where this workshop is. So you've kind of got right now a sore spot for a lot of people because it's like, we want to see this done, we want to see a parking area, we want to see this look beautiful. But at the same time, Article 14 is the removal of, in my opinion, a historical building because it has agricultural significance. And I've gone down a road in chatting with the Historical Commission in the past because through open space, we've been trying to make sure that land is treated as a historical location because we feel as though the agricultural significance is important. But to jump back, this article, if we don't bring it to the town, we don't have a chance to discuss it, a chance to debate it, right?
Right.
The debates are happening through CPC. If you don't have a good public hearing or if you don't have enough people represented from the community to talk, the board members are only going to be able to know what themselves. So if the four of us had to make a decision, we would only have our four mindsets without talking to people.
Right.
So this is nice. It gives 200. This was one of the points made at the meeting, that you now have 250 people able to make a decision. And then there's another side saying, now I have to convince 250 people not to remove. So it's going to be a in my opinion, I think it's going to be a contentious article.
What's the cost on that?
$200K. $200,000.
Wow.
That went up, I believe it was $195 before.
Longer you wait, the more it's going up.
Yeah. Or it comes down on its own.
Yeah.
Are each of these being done as a separate article?
So this 14 is its own article.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay.
This removal. The amount they condensed all of them for Article 13, and I believe the CPC had a workshop as well where the gentleman that came on was like, "We'd like you to separate them so that you have enough information on the article for people to understand." So that's why on Article 13, a lot of people coming to the meeting will see now there is a project description of what's going to be happening.
Yeah,
and there's also now sources next to and who submitted them. So. Yeah. In my opinion, Article 13 looks well written and very professional.
Good.
So again, getting back to that workshop, we'll see what happens. One of the points was that CPC funding should not be used for removal.
Yeah.
And I have to agree with that to a limitation. And I say that only because when we get a project and we put in for a project, you encompass everything together. So one of my positions was that, all right, we're putting this in at 200,000. What if we had combined them together with the construction of the trail?
Correct.
Would it have reduced it? There was a waffling back and forth of an uncertainty. That's my position on it. I don't believe it was looked at in that manner, but if you're encompassing in a project and you need an area to park and that structure is there, say this structure was in worse condition than it is right now, mm-hmm. right? You would assume that you would be tearing it down because you'd be putting something new there.
Yeah.
That's the idea of it, that you would use the funds for as a project base.
Right.
But it's a tough one, and that's why you have the board. You have all these panel members that are able to discuss and debate this.
Okay. So let's go on.
There was a precedent, though, for purchasing a property and tearing it down. Dillon Mechanesby Park. There was a house in front. They bought the lot, they tore it down, and that's where the parking lot is now.
But that was encompassed in the whole project, right?
But it was all paid by CPC.
Right.
So demolition was associated with by no means was the home that was raised a historical house.
No.
So I that's mean there's a different tack to it, right?
But I think that was a good point, that it was part of the whole project. It wasn't a separate project.
And so that in looking at project bases, you know, you need a funding for it. You know, when, for instance, you know, if you have a bridge that needs to be built for a town, you know, there's different funding sources. Sometimes they get it from the federal government. Sometimes they have state grants for a municipality, right? So there's different funding areas. It's up to the people on the panel to figure out or to present this as what percentage they would want from CPC or if they would want to go to, say, free cash.
Right. By the way, that Dillon Mechanesby Park was essentially dead. I was the chairman
of
the board,
I
resurrected it. But I'll never get credit for that. I got it resurrected because I was the chairman of the board and got the parties together, and we ended up going full speed ahead. But that's for another day. Tell us about the tennis courts now.
So the tennis courts now. Yeah. So originally they were supposed to be at Parker Avenue.
Yep.
And I was excited about that, being a Parker Avenue student. So if you drive by that field, I used to drive by and you'd be some weeds growing up on the sides. And I also play t-ball there. So to not see it used or not see it active kind of bothered me. Well, they brought it forward. I should say, when I say they, this was kind of a collaboration between the town manager and Stephen Stone, the superintendent. And it kind of fell to the wayside because construction costs were going through the roof, mm-hmm. which we're seeing that everywhere right now. But when I was looking at the proposal, I was like, five courts? And then they needed the electrical conduits. They need electricity. The electricity alone, I think, was about $300,000 that was listed there. And I was like, hey, red flag, like, I think we can reduce this cost and make this still happen.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we had the meeting. It was basically dead in the water. And I said, I'd like to motion to put this on the next agenda. Mm-hmm. I'd like to give an opportunity for the superintendent to come in and discuss. That happened. The board agreed. Mm-hmm. Next meeting came up. This came on our plate. And I was like, whoa, all right. You know, this is happening. I had no idea. One of those situations where you walk in, the agenda had said it wasn't happening.
Mm-hmm.
But The superintendent came in, gave a nice presentation, and we had a contract from a firm that was going to do this all the way up to construction and provide construction services as well, I believe. And so now it's happening, and it's able to happen down at the high school complex.
Where in the high school complex will it be?
Down by where I used to do the shot put. There is a shot put area. I believe they play lacrosse all the way in the back left. If you're coming down the complex, all the way in the back left. So it's going to be next to the current track. And okay. A little bit near, it's kind
of
tucked away.
It doesn't take anything
there.
Away from any of the other fields,
it
right?
It doesn't. And that shot put pad, they'll probably be able to locate that in a new spot. I'm sure the high school will set that up.
Yeah.
I'm excited about that spot because now they have the utilities already there. They have the surveillance already available.
Right.
And now the high school can have a tennis team.
Yes.
So MIAA requires 4 courts.
Mm-hmm.
In order to host.
Right.
So now this gives an opportunity for our town to also host events. And, you know, there was debate back and forth, you know, are we going to be providing the schools now with courts?
Exactly.
And I understand that. I understand that aspect of it, and we debated it. But this is available to all of us. And I know that there was issues before with the field, and that got brought up, and I made a point to say it. I said, I'm sure with the superintendent here, he hears this, and he understands what this board's wishes are. And so I have faith in him, and I'm giving him the benefit of the doubt going forward with
yeah.
this.
Yeah. I'm going to throw this out because there's a big issue with the football field, and there's limited use by Pop Warner on the football field, and there are, from my overall, you know, people bring all mm-hmm. the problems to us, right? Because they want us to expose it if
they
we
like
can,
us to
right?
talk about
and
it.
And that's
yeah.
why, and we, they want to talk about it. So the bottom line is, the football field and Pop Warner had an agreement to use it for but they put all kinds of obstacles in front of them. You know, there's fees and this and that, but, you know, the town taxpayers paid for it with CPC money, and it should be used more, or at least 40% of the time for the citizenry that wants to use it. You can't restrict it to down to 10% of the time.
Yeah, I would be curious to know. I have not myself dove deep into it, and I'd be curious to hear more about it because I remember playing on the baseball field next door. That's where you practiced, and you never touched that field until the kicker touched the field.
Right.
And every so often you'd get a chance to, on Thursdays, we would do, you know, the shorts and shoulder pads only. And that's when we practiced, and we practiced like it was a game, but yeah. little.
Well, I don't want to carry that ball for Pop Warner, but I'm hoping that Pop Warner or somebody will step up at town meeting and talk about the use of CPC monies for the expanded use of the community and not only for schools. So that has to be addressed.
Because that was for the grading, right? Because
right.
the CPC doesn't allow you to use it for turf fields.
Right. Correct. Right. Well, it was a lot of money was spent there.
That's something, you know, if there's someone from that group that, you know, they
yeah.
feel as though they're being
we'd
pushed
love to hear from them.
Yeah.
You
should.
Anybody talking on our Facebook page there?
There's a lot of talk.
All right, let's hear it. Let's get some of it in here.
So Jim said that Green Meadow was bought by Target. So it's going to be a Target warehouse facility.
Oh, okay.
Distribution center.
Yeah. Oh, wow. That's good.
People wondering where Richard is. He's Richard has chimed in saying he's studying for his finals.
Yep.
And he'll be with us next time.
Yeah, so that's it, huh? But we have a lot of people online watching, and that's good. And we want you involved, and we want you to, you know, send us along some of our some questions, and
yep.
we'll absolutely try to get them answered.
But
here.
Real quickly, on the tennis court, I think it's a good thing for the town.
Yes.
It also gives another sport, possibly for the Recreation Commission, right, to take. And speaking of Recreation Commission, I want to send a big shout-out. Lori Cahill is retiring after a long period as recreation and conservation yeah. director. So congratulations, Lori, and have a great retirement. She has like 20 days left. So I met up with her at the store the other day, and she filled me in. So I worked with her for about 15 years as the representative for the basketball
right.
program, and it was a pleasure working with her.
Yeah.
She's amazing.
There's also going to be pickleball there, right?
Yes, there's discussion about dual lines or if there'll be a pickleball-specific court. You know, a lot of times these projects come over and, you know, is this CPC funded? Yes. This or does it fit the CPC rules?
Yeah.
Yes. And we kind of give a lot of freedom to the applicant to allow, you know, yes, your project does, according to what you've provided us, continue. So I'm curious to see if they end up doing four for construction. You know, they're going to be given options, and they're going to be, the superintendent will be able to talk with the engineering firm that's going to be designing this to lay this out for him.
So how much is that project?
That project right now, just as a
design,
I believe it was $85,000.
Okay.
And that all of these have the contingencies added into them.
What else, real quick, because we got
to
move on.
Sure, I apologize. I'm taking up a ton of time. Colburn House is going to be in the Harmony Hall. There's an ADA compliancy and it's fixing up some of the areas around it. There's some dry rot throughout. You know, like there's, you know, clapboard that needs to be fixed. Let's see. There's a transferring for community housing reserve. But yeah, it's actually that was the abbreviated quick version. Yeah.
That's good. So any other questions on?
No, I'm sure we'll head in next. Well, next.
Next show we'll get a little bit more extensive
absolutely,
into it because we'll
absolutely.
Have the actual articles in front of us and see where it goes. The budget itself is a huge budget.
Maybe Rob will come. Will Grace us come back?
Come back.
We'd love to come back.
Kind of get more in depth into the weeds and get real wonky about it.
Absolutely. So at this point in the game, I think what we're going to do is we're going to take a little bit of a break. And show a piece by Richard that Richard put together for us. It's about 9 or 10 minutes long, and it's a very interesting piece about the St. Joseph's Workers' Shrine in Lowell. And he had a sit down with the pastor there, and he asked him some questions. Richard posed some questions relative to where the church stands in relation to youth of today. So we'll play that now.
Hello, John and the gang back at the studio. This is your ace reporter, Richard Silvio, your man on the street. I am currently at St. Joseph's Workers' Shrine on Lee Street in the heart of downtown Lowell, where I'm conducting an interview with Father Mike on the relationship of the youth and the church and what you can do to help bring people back to the church. St. Joseph's is a beautiful shrine. I was so happy to have them invite me, and of course they extend a humble invitation to you to come join them for Mass one of these days. All right, let's get to the interview.
Young and old, male and female, from Alabama to Hong Kong, many Lowell citizens find their peace of mind right here at St. Joseph's Workers' Shrine in the heart of downtown Lowell. Since the death of Jesus Christ on the cross 2,000 years ago, Christianity has spread like wildfire across the globe. The burning passion which millions experience for Christ has made Christianity the largest religion in the world, with many denominations. Catholicism happens to be the largest, boasting more than 1.5 billion members worldwide. Many say it is the Catholic teachings of love taken directly from Christ himself which preserve the body of the church. It is a wonder to many, then, why church attendance rates have dropped dramatically in the last 50 years. Today I sat down with the director of the shrine, Father Mike Amisi, to discuss the faith and what we as Catholics can do to bring a new generation of young people back to the church.
All right, I am joined with Father Michael here at St. Joseph's Workers' Shrine. Now, Father Michael, I did some of my expert online researching, and I pulled up some facts. Mm-hmm. At least I hope they're facts, if we can confirm them. You grew up in Montreal, Canada.
Yes.
You were ordained in Boston in 1904. 1984.
Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, 84. 80 years later than 04.
Excuse me.
Okay. Well,
you can't trust everything you read online.
Yeah.
You've been the director here since 2020.
That's right. Yes.
And you have you're concentrating on faith formation and vocational recruitment.
Yes, I am. Yes.
Let me set the record straight for a few things. I did some online research here, and according to the internet, only 40% of Catholics attend church regularly. 73% of young Catholics say that they can be a good Catholic without going to church. How do you respond to that?
The church has a lot to offer. A lot to offer us. Jesus formed the church. It came out of his side when he was, when the soldier struck him with the spear. Blood and water came out. Who was there? It was his mother Mary and Saint John. They represented the church. Later on, 50 days later, the Holy Spirit came upon the apostles and the disciples gathered in the upper room. Jesus wants a church because it's there that we can find the foundations of our faith.
So, Father Michael, do you think it is possible to be a good Catholic without going to church?
Anything is possible. And so, yes, it is possible to do that. But I would be lost. I wouldn't put it at the top of the list. Mm-hmm. But without the church, I would be lost because of my stubborn nature, my wanting to do things at times my way. The church is there to keep me on track.
You know, personally, this isn't about me, but giving a personal anecdote, I made my confirmation and communion this Easter, and it has helped me greatly being in the church. And one thing that I find to be remarkable is the gift, I like to call it, of confession. Because you have so many Catholics who say, you know, I haven't been in 30 years, what would they say? Mm-hmm. Or, you know, I don't need confession, or I'm too afraid. But personally, I find it very therapeutic. You know, if you have somebody coming into the confessional and they say to you, you know, Father Michael, I haven't been in 30 years, what are you thinking?
Well, first of all, I don't think anything negative. There's a reason why it's been 30 years. Just today, maybe three times, I thought about things I did long ago. That said, oh boy, that was dumb. You know, I was wrong in what I did there. So, okay, so even though I do go to confession often, there's things that we think of long ago that God has forgiven, but I'm happy to see them.
So what are some things that you would consider non-negotiable? Some, whether it be holy days or going to confession at least once a year, what are some things that you think is a must if you're a Catholic?
If you're a Catholic, the Blessed Mother Mary, there's a lot of people who aren't Catholic who see Mary as a stumbling block. You know, there's not much in the Bible about Mary, but what we have are so deep and that Mary gave us Jesus, and we go to Jesus through Mary.
A big problem we see today is the youth. You know, like I said earlier, 73% of young people do not feel that it's necessary to go to church, okay? But as we've discussed, church does so much for one's soul and for one's spirit, right? What do you think parents can do, Catholic parents can do to help, or really of any religion, help their kids come back to church?
First thing is prayer. Prayer. Many young people are going to go, they're going to follow their own mind. It may or may not be the mind of Christ. And for that reason, I would say for a mother and a father, especially the mother, pray, storm heaven. It will have an effect on the child, on the youth.
Do you think so?
I know so, because I was one of them.
God bless you.
I was, yeah, really.
You know, we talk about how Jesus Christ formed the church, okay? What is his overall message above everything else?
Overall message would be, mercy. Mercy. I think that there's few people that say, I'm perfect, I've done everything right. Most of us say, we've made a mess. You know, we need help. Okay, well, where do we go to? Okay, we go to Christ, and there he is on the cross. I did this for you. I'm doing this for you now. I did this for you.
Now, what do we say to those individuals who, again, don't know a lot about the faith, and out of ignorance, they say things like, you know, Catholics are just self-haters. They're so focused on their imperfections.
No, no. I think if you're human, if you're human, you're going to look back. When you get older, you're going to look back and you say, could have done it better. Okay, and that's where God is there saying, okay, but I'll take care of it. You know, I'm going to clean up the mess. Okay, you can't, but I can clean up the mess by redeeming it. And I noticed that the mistakes that I made, the sins that I committed, God made good come out of them when I owned up to them. It is good that you exist. It is good that you exist. Because very often, dog-eat-dog world, the message is, okay, it's not good that you exist. I just need you to get ahead, or I just need you to do me this favor. No, it's good that you exist. Those of you who might be discouraged, begin again. Begin again. Pick yourself up and just begin again and go to Christ. Go to Christ. He'll lead you in many, many ways. But if he leads you to the church, that's going to double the energy that you're going to need to begin again.
I'm sure you invite anybody to come out anytime. It's a trend. Is it open all the time for people to come down?
It's open usually from about 6:30 in the morning till about 6:30 at night, so okay. 12 hours.
It's beautiful. That's an opportunity, especially if you have a student in Lowell, or you know that either goes to Lowell High or attends a college here in Lowell. Yeah. It's a perfect opportunity after class to just come by and even just to take a look around. You know, not even to participate, just to look around. Thank you very much for joining me, Father Michael.
You're welcome. God bless you.
God bless you. Thank you.
God bless you too. Thanks.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to return to John in the studio. Thank you very much for giving us this opportunity to speak from St. Joseph's Shrine. Have a good night, fellas.
How you doing? We're back at the studio here, and that was a very good piece, Richard. Thank you very much for that work on that. I think it's an interesting piece to be said. I don't think enough of our millennial types have a propensity to be closer or to even think about God, right? I mean, as you find
Yes, and it's a matter of kind of self-reflection, which a lot of people just don't do these days to begin with.
Right, because I think most of our societal ills today are because people don't believe in anything anymore.
Right. Yeah, correct.
You know, so anyways, very good piece, Richard. Now we're going to move on to the next subject that we have here. We have a couple of things that we want to run through real quick. We have a Dracut Town election coming up, and that is on May 6th,
a Saturday.
May 6th, and it's a Saturday. And didn't they just change the hours? They changed the hours from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m., I believe.
Right. So normally they're
7 to 8. 7 a.m. to 8 p.m.
Yeah.
And
they reduce them.
Yeah. I'm still.
They do have early voting and absentee voting that's still.
Yeah. I get why they're doing it on a Saturday. But, there are those out there that will always talk, Rob, about the fact that we're taking away time for people to come. Do you agree with that at all? With all of the different types of ability or different times that they can go and vote?
That we're taken away from it? This year it's a uncontested race,
right?
No,
it isn't uncontested, but this is permanent, I think, right? The change, or is it just
I don't know. I think it was driven mostly because it's an uncontested race.
Okay. Well, as long as it's going to go back at some point, I don't mind that. You have any opinion on that?
Well, you hear that all the time that, you know, they're restricting the vote. Well, this is obviously restricting the vote, right? Because they're condensing the time, and I get it because people don't want to be there for 13 hours or whatever.
Yeah. You're disenfranchising a lot of people
correct.
When you do that, you know?
But, I mean, we know here in Dracut, people don't vote anyway. In generally speaking,
not
a low percentage of people vote
very
anyway.
Very low, and you're going to see even lower this time around. And, of course, you see the selectmen candidates have their signs out, and I think Renee Young has put some signs out, but there's no contested races whatsoever.
Right.
There's also been some issues with Dracut Water Supply District. They're also having a not an issue, but they're having a an election at the same time.
That's correct. So within the district boundary, there's an election to fill the remainder of the term that was created when Bob Corey passed away.
Did you hear during the last Board of Selectmen meeting, which was last night, the manager mentioned that there's going to be a new fee schedule proposed?
Fee schedule for?
For all the different fees in town.
Oh.
They haven't been raised in some time.
Undoubtedly.
Some time, yeah. So I'm wondering if the selectmen candidates, who I think have pledged not to raise any fees or taxes, are going to go along with that. Are they going to vote yes?
I would bet my last dollar they will vote for the fee increases.
Yeah, well, a fee is still part of taxes in my estimation, right? Because if you took all of the things that we spend through the course of a year that we spend our own earned money on, I'll bet you 50% of our pay goes to different fees, taxes, or whatever. Somewhere along the line.
I'm assuming it's going to be like permits and things like that.
It's all of that.
All of that.
You think the mattress fee will come up again?
Yes.
And do you think it'll pass?
Yes.
You do?
Yep.
Interesting. Especially after the chair had said that she would not vote for any fees.
Hmm.
Is that a promise made?
Promise not kept. Yeah.
Not kept.
Yeah.
You know, so that's going to be interesting. Charter review, Phil. You know, what do you think? They're going to have 7 members of that charter review committee that are going to be appointed?
Yeah, so, you know, the last time it was reconfigured, the last time it was truly looked at, 1985, that was done by a charter commission that was, I believe, elected.
Yeah,
there
I don't understand how
11 members on that particular
that were
commission
elected.
That were elected.
Yeah.
I would rather see a charter commission that's elected rather than appointed.
You know, given the fact that we now are, everybody's sweating for the town meeting to have whether or not we're going to get enough people there for a quorum. We need 250 people there. And with 44 articles.
And they try to always make it smaller.
Well, they can't.
But they've tried.
They tried, not for this financial one. So they need 250 people to show up and stay in the room until the meeting's adjourned.
Yep.
To make sure that meeting is solid, you know, have a quorum all the way
right
through. Because anybody could challenge a quorum count at
yeah,
any time.
At any point.
Boy. So that would be interesting to see what happens. But isn't this, with this charter review, a good time to really look into the fact of what's going on with town meeting? Do you think town meeting really has met its time?
Yes.
I, you know, Rob, with a well over $100 million budget, do you think that town meeting with special interests, that mostly special interests that attend the meeting, you think it's really ready to go to a town council type of a form of government and expand the Board of Selectmen? In my view, I've been advocating for that for a number of years. Kind of do districts and give more opportunity.
Each district
to
should have a representative. Yeah.
Because you don't have many people from the East Dracut or
right,
Central Dracut
correct
that serve.
No, I, as a matter of fact, I think 3 of our selectmen come from Collinsville.
Yeah. See, that's not a real diverse.
Bring up an interesting point too with the school committee.
Yeah.
You know, who's from the Campbell District? I believe. No. Just Mr.
Yeah,
Loki.
That's East Dracut, part of East Dracut, yeah. And we're going to be spending a lot of money in that area in the coming years. So that's going to be interesting to see who they put on those committees, you know. But we'll see where we go with that. Let's talk a little bit briefly about the fireworks at Veterans Park. What's your view on that, Phil? I mean, Gordy.
Well, they said they're going to have it at Veterans Park, and it's going to be reduced. They're not going to be used as big of fireworks, so they're going to be smaller, and they're going to reduce the number of people. I don't know how you're going to restrict people that want to show up in a public place to.
How are they going to reduce the number of people? Have you heard that?
Yeah, that's what they said last night. The fire chief said they're going to use smaller fireworks. They're
yeah
not going to be as big, and they're going to reduce the footprint of how far they go, and they're going to reduce the number of people that show up. I don't know how you're going to reduce the number of people that show up because it's a public place.
Well, I think they're combining it with safety night too,
which turned out to be a
big event last year.
1,800.
I don't know where people are going to park. It's going to be a nightmare.
Now I know.
And I think Renee.
Rob squirming his chair right now. He's excited.
He's bristling.
I fully support the fireworks being held in Dracut. I'm just not wedded to this idea that you're taking it from the 65-acre place and putting it in a 10-acre place and expect to not have big issues.
Right.
Right? And I want fireworks, but I want the fireworks to be done the right way and not cheap out on it. Because basically, I mean, I'm a gaslighter.
Yeah. That's what they're going to say.
Yeah. But Rob is, you know, as a kid, he remembers going down to this cool complex. And you know, I remember bringing my little girls down there. And it was a great night because there was all kinds of activities going on prior. There was a concert. Yep. It was a great night on the 4th of July. And through the years, we've just picked away at it. And now it's reduced to nothing.
Hey, I wanted to be back like the Sandlot, you know, when they're all the kids are, you know, out in the summer and, hey, they're at a carnival, right? Yeah. I mean, minus the Big Man Chew incident, but anyways.
Phil, I can't believe that there was no pushback from the neighborhood. Do you?
I mean, considering that the neighborhood complained, has been...
About lights.
Complaining about lights and resistant against lights. Now you're going to throw up fireworks and some concussions and stuff like that. Or perhaps they don't have the concussive grenades anymore. And
it's the most densely populated area.
It is.
Dracut, I believe. And, you know, if it's not the first, it's close to being the first. And I think that it's going to be a nightmare that night. I absolutely think it's going to be a nightmare. It's gonna just to get in and out of there. Don't forget, if you're doing the public safety issue there too, you're gonna have trucks, food trucks there, mm-hmm. right? And where's the parking?
Well, it's gonna go across the street, and it's gonna affect Brothers Pizza and all the businesses over the Yangs in the corner. It's gonna affect the
Scholas.
All those places are gonna be because there's gonna be no parking. So,
right. That typically that's a shared parking. So when the businesses are operating, the offices and such, the restaurants really aren't chugging away at full steam.
Correct.
Yeah. And then when the business is closed, the restaurants need all that space.
Right.
But I know that they are going to provide shuttles, supposedly. Are they going to park them?
I guess they're going to park at the school and shuttle people over. Where else is there a parking lot?
In front of John Zimini's house.
Yes, definitely.
That's where I'm parking.
Wait a minute. I see an economic opportunity here for me.
How many can you fit on your lawn?
$10 a car?
Yeah.
Put it right on my lawn.
Yeah.
My driveway, $10.
And if I'm Brothers, I'm definitely saying, hey, we've got slices available right here.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I know Frobie's would be closed. It'd be great if Frobie's was open for ice cream, though.
Yeah.
It's interesting. I appreciate all of your points, right? Because, you know, there's always a different side to the coin,
right?
And the way I view it is you have to start somewhere. You have to try. You can't not try it. Because in my opinion, you have to learn somewhere, right?
Can't you use Beaver Brook?
You know, there are plenty of beautiful land in this town that we could use. And
where do you park?
Do you know what Pelham does theirs? Yes.
Where?
Pelham does theirs. No, I'm sorry, not Pelham. Amesbury. Because one of my daughters lives in Amesbury. And they do it in on a farm, a big, huge farm. And they park on the lawn. They park on the field.
Hey, I would love Old Home Day at the very end of the night. Everyone kind of, you know, trucks their way over, or you can see it in the distance from Beaverbrook Farm, you know, at the end of Old Home Day. There's plenty of opportunity. And what's great is, you know, we're all talking about it. We're all trying to say, hey, what about this? Or, you know, hey, what's wrong? You know, we've got this parking issue here. You've got Four Oaks right at the top. It's another opportunity, too, even for Grazzi. If I'm ending that night, though, me and my family are probably looking for some ice cream. So if I was Frobie's, I'm open. Or if, hey, I'm Farmer Dave's, they're starting to do ice cream. Maybe they'll have a booth there too. Who knows? I appreciate everyone's kind of concern too about, you know, the sound, you know, and are the neighbors going to be upset? They were upset at the lighting. I'm hoping that they're able to have an opportunity to speak. It's being broadcasted, like you said. Were they notified?
And where are people going to stand? And where are gonna
you know, it's kind of the way I look at it. I grew up, again, I always say it. I grew up on Long Pond, right? Everyone knows this fireworks at the pond every so often, right? I mean, it's everyone's very patriotic throughout the entire summer at Long Pond. Now,
Long Pond will put any city to shame.
Shame, yeah, exactly. Yeah,
I mean, well, we have a couple of comments online about this particular subject that we're talking about.
Sure.
And, you know, a couple of people are saying the fireworks will be a joke. It's going to be in terms of what you're going to see,
right,
for fireworks.
Right.
I think that's what they meant. And it's also going to be a real bad situation with parking and traffic at that. You're going from a three-lane or a multi-lane Lakeview
in 113, people are going
to
be
to two
people
lanes.
That don't care about the fireworks and just trying to get through.
Yeah,
it's going to
be a nightmare.
Here's the other thing too, though. If you can't really see the fireworks as you're approaching, but they're going off, you're going, well, all right, hey, let's go somewhere to eat right now, or hey, let's go over
maybe
this place now.
But there's another guy that says Christos Marinos. Okay, he said that Beaverbrook Farm would be perfect, and I agree. I think Beaverbrook Farm would be perfect.
Let's chat with the ad hoc committee.
It would be perfect, but I suspect there's, you're not going to like this statement, Robert, but there's a certain chairman of a board that will not want it there for whatever reason. I guarantee that.
You know what? I'm going to bring it up.
No, good. I hope you do. Good, because it should be there, and it should be on the 4th of July or close to the 4th of July.
Or the 3rd or 4th or whatever. Yeah, right.
It should be there on
it
that
It shouldn't
time.
Be on June 15th or June.
Isn't there also a restriction on Veterans Park being used
so
as a
fairground? So that is interesting, because there was a restriction for prohibiting fairs and carnivals. At Veterans Park.
Ooh.
Completely.
Is it within the recreation restriction?
Completely.
Has that been filed?
Yeah. All right, so let's move on. Betty Ann Drive, because we're down to 5 minutes,
wow,
and I haven't got to any national stuff. Betty Ann Drive, a quick synopsis.
Great
of
news for the soccer program.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so I was watching the selectman meeting last night, and all of a sudden, you know, this topic comes up under community input about Betty Ann Drive, and it's like, well, you know, what's this about? So I did some quick investigation as far as I could. Nate, if you could put up the first slide, BAL1. This is Betty Ann Lane.
Right.
And that marker is essentially the lot that is involved. Nate, you can start to toggle through the next slides. So apparently the owner of the house has built a soccer field in his backyard.
Is that the field?
That's all pavement, yes. So he actually paved it. I believe it looks like hot top. So these photographs were provided to me by somebody who has some knowledge. He took those photographs with his phone off for Facebook as he was kind of going
soccer
through.
On
yeah
pavement?
So why don't we stop at this one, Nate? So he built essentially a concession stand.
Oh my God.
So if you want to go to the next one, so he's selling food and drink out of it.
Oh my God!
Without even a common victuals license.
Has Dan Phelps been up there to
exploit I don't know. Maybe the chairman of the planning of the selectmen could be up there cutting a ribbon. Who knows?
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, it's just kind of remarkable that within this residential subdivision, this person, I guess they recently bought the house. Put up an 8-foot fence around the property and then paved the entire lot so they could play soccer.
And they said, this is my land.
We're going to keep an eye on that one. Hey, guys, what do you think about Joe Biden announcing for real quick hits on this? Joe Biden announcing that he's running for re-election. What do you think, Gordy?
If he makes it that long.
You think he might? I mean,
if his brain
and
stays
he's
together.
Keeping Kamala. So that.
Yeah.
What? I mean, the guy is 1 foot on the in the grave and one on the banana peel. What do you think, Phil, real quick?
I'll say the three words that Michael Scott would usually say. No, no, no!
Yeah, exactly. look at this chart. Let's put up that one about the inflation where everything has gone up. You know that little sticker that I did that? You know, look at this. A dozen of eggs, March of 22, of just last year was $2.05, right? And now it's gone up. Eggs have gone up 30.5%. Air travel's gone up. You can put the next slide up. Air travel's gone up 42.9. Wow. Chicken has gone up 17%. The cost of sheltering has gone up to almost 7%. Vehicles, I think that figure's a little bit low, to be honest with you. But this is just some of the stuff that Biden's going to run on, and I'm hoping and I'm praying. I mean, the used cars and trucks, 35% up.
Yep. Can you if believe you can it? Find one.
Air travel is up.
Good for selling.
Air travel is up by 23%. The cost of air travel. I mean, this is like, if the Republican Party doesn't grab on this and just talk about the issues of your pocketbook and just keep talking, banging that away. And, you know, I'm a Trump fan, and I'm not a Trump person fan or his personality, but I'm a Trump policies man. And, I mean, what they've done to him is beyond the pale, but even further than that is the fact that if Trump just keeps pounding at this economic stuff, because prior to COVID, we were all making money, and the middle class was not being squeezed. The last thing I'm going to talk about before we go off, and then I'll give you a little bit of what's coming up soon. The fact that Biden's plan on mortgages, have you read that one yet? Anybody that has a score higher than 625 or 650 for your credit score is going to be penalized for being a good person and a person who has been good with your finances. You're now going to be penalized 1% of the cost. So if you go in for a mortgage instead of a 6% mortgage, you're going to be charged 7% because of your credit score. And that's all in the guise of supporting equity with those that didn't do well at their finances. Can you imagine that? Talk about squeezing the middle class even further. And this is a direct effect caused by regulations from the Biden administration. What do you say about that, Phil?
Well, it's just promoting bad behavior. That's what else can you say?
You know, we all saw Tucker Carlson get canned the other day, right? And basically, I guess it was a parting of the ways. But Tucker, brought with him almost 4 million viewers. Yep. And Fox lost 17% of their shares. And that's equates to almost $5 billion, right? $1 billion. And Bud Light, with their fiasco, they've lost $5 billion. But yeah. Folks, I just wanted to tell you a little bit about what's coming up in the near future. We've got a lot of things going on. And Gordy, one of them is
the teachers union.
The teachers union wants to come in and talk to us. And we're going to negotiate that with them and have them on a show in the very near future. And we have a blockbuster show coming up very soon that's going to involve a town employee, a former town employee, who was totally vilified and egregiously mistreated. He wants to come in and tell his story. So we'll have more on that. We're working out the logistics of that right now. But Gordy, seeing as you're the guy that didn't get much to say today because we squeezed you out, close this show out.
Well, folks, thanks for watching. We enjoy that you watch our show. Stay tuned for next episode, our 50th episode. Congratulations, guys, on the 50th episode.
Next show will be the 50th episode.
That's correct. And when it's Wednesday and it's 6:30, it's What's Happening, Drake It. Good night, Drake It.